specifically for our mission report, and so glad to have you here this morning. Just going to start off with some announcements, and really don't have a whole lot of announcements. Just take a look at your bulletin, see what's going on. Of course, we have our evening service tonight, Children in Action, WVU on Monday, and then, of course, we've got their youth and choir on Wednesday. Our book study is over, so we're going to, you know, start adult studies again in September when we begin Growing Together. So that's coming around the corner. But also make note that we have our fish fry coming up August 16th. There's some information there in the bulletin. Anything else that I need to mention? Okay. So the slideshow that you just saw that kind of kicked us off was from a past mission trip, kind of leading up to this recent trip that the youth went on. You'll see another slideshow later, and you'll hear some reports from them. And so after our time of prayer, we'll turn it over to Alex and the crew for that. Yeah, we'll go ahead and go into our time of prayer requests. So one of our deacons, Ray, why don't you come up and share those with us. Bow your head with me. We'll take a moment and then I'll close this in prayer. Take this time to quiet our hearts before you, to trust you with our burdens, cast our cares upon you, these specific requests that were given concerning health issues, and we know there are many unspoken ones as well, for our nation, Lord. Just there's so many things going on that that can burden us, things that also we want to know how we can be a part of change, Lord. And so help us, Lord, to first of all to have our hearts set upon you, Lord, and just help us, Lord, to know how we are to engage in this world, Lord. We pray that as we continue in the service, that you bless this time of worship as we celebrate what has happened in this recent youth mission trip, Lord. We just pray that all glory goes to you. We pray all this in Jesus' name.
Good morning. It's good to be here with you all this morning, and very happy that we get to celebrate what God was able to do through the mission trip that we recently went on. And before I kind of give a little report on that, can I just have you guys, those of you who went on the trip, stand up real quick? And everybody, I want to just give them a round of applause for serving the rest of the day. I mean, it is a really fun trip, but I mean, it does take something to go and to be obedient enough to follow. God work through each and every one of their lives. So pretty much the whole week, I heard about how this trip was different than all the past trips, because this trip was crammed within like a week. So we got there on Monday and left on a Friday. And normally, I think you guys get there on Friday night and then are all the way until the next Friday, correct? So it's like much longer. There's a lot more packed into it. And so I kind of got a condensed little nugget version of it. But we got there on Monday and kind of got settled in. And then Tuesday, I felt like it was just kind of a cram-packed day of like breakout sessions and kind of trying to figure out where I even was and what we were doing. And I think they kind of got some of the same kind of prep that they normally get. And then it was Wednesday. Wednesday and Thursday were really neat for me to see because, you know, whereas, you know, we were kind of there at the church to Monday and Tuesday just kind of getting ready and getting prepared and briefed for what we were going to be doing. Wednesday and Thursday, I got to go with these guys out into the community there in Fenton, where we were based, and be able to see them like serve the Lord and like take care packages out to people who had been isolated in their homes, and be able to take food and be able to visit people in nursing homes, to be able to people who haven't seen the light of day hardly since all of this has taken place. And so, and I was very impressed, to be completely honest with you, because so some of these guys in youth, or when I met them around the church, very quiet and very timid, and I barely hear two words out of them or whatever. And they were talking to people and going up to, you know, we kind of had to stay distanced, but, you know, going up to houses and giving care packages and talking to people that wanted to talk. And it was great to see that. And particularly at the nursing homes, because we were going up and seeing people who, like I said, they were locked in. I mean, literally locked in there. Could not really be in contact with anybody outside, and being able to see them show love to those people, being able to pray with them, being able to talk with them, that was really a huge blessing for me. But honestly, one of the biggest blessings for me wasn't actually like, you know, it was a huge blessing for me to be able to go out into the community. But the thing is like, you know, a short-term mission trip is a blessing. But eventually those people are going to run out of the things in the care packages, they're going to run out of the food, and they're going to still have to live their lives. And so, you know, seeing the seeds of faith that were planted there was a tremendous blessing. But for me, honestly, a lot of it was being able to bond with more with the youth group, being able to spend time with the guys and the girls. And some of them are adults and aren't in the youth group anymore, but still being able to make better friendships with them. And it was just really an awesome, blessed time to see the Lord working in each of their lives during the worship and the preaching as we were serving in the community. It was just really a great opportunity for me to draw closer to them and to be able to kind of see the Lord working in their lives. And so I'm going to kind of cut my time off here, because I know we have at least a few people. Raise your hand real quick if you're planning on speaking. Raise it high. Be proud. All right, so we've got a few people who are in a little bit are going to come up and give testimony, so I don't want to take too much time up here, but I just want to say that the Lord really was working. It was awesome to see what he was doing through them and the community, and it was really encouraging just to be a part of the whole team that was reaching that community. So I'm going to let the slideshow play, and then we're going to enter into a time of worship after that, so enjoy the slideshow.
Yeah.
this morning. As we enter into a time of worship, I just want to encourage you with this verse, Philippians 1:6. It says, "And I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ." And that's such a wonderful blessing this morning, that if you are a believer, if you are born again, that God has begun a work in you that he will bring to completion. He promises that. So if you would, please stand, and we will worship together this morning. There's probably going to be some unfamiliar songs to you guys, but that's all right. We're gonna learn them and love them, all right?
I saw Satan fall like lightning. I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. I believe in signs and wonders. I have resurrection power. Still the miracle that I just can't get over. My name is registered in heaven. Yes, my place belongs to you forever. This is my testimony from death to life. Cause Scripture wrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'll testify. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. Come together, sons and daughters, all with blood and washed in water. Sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father, our God. We'll finish what we started. Yes, our God, we'll finish what we started. This is my testimony, from death to life. Cause Christ, we wrote my story. I'll testify, by Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony. I'm not dead, and you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. I'm not dead, and you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, and you're not done. Greater things are still.
Greater things are still to come. Thank you. to us, they they kind of thought that there were strings attached, like, oh, well, we're Muslim, is that okay with you? Like, is there going to be any sort of problem if we're Muslim and we take this care package? So it was just kind of sad to, I don't know, see how people that aren't Christians, they might have some other ideas of what Christianity is, and we were just going out and giving them a care package because they were people needed right now, and he thought that there would be strings attached and that he would have to compromise things that he believed and things that he did in his daily life just to take a care package from us. So it was just kind of sad to see, but it was also really good to be able to potentially plant that seed and say, like, hey, there's no strings attached, we just want to give you some love, and we know, like, this is a really hard time for you guys. So, yeah, that was really cool to see. And I also think that this entire mission trip, like, in the past, we've been so focused on pouring into children and, like, spreading the gospel. And yes, that's still what we were doing this year. But I think this year was really, really good in the middle of COVID because, at least for me personally and some other people that I've spoken to, COVID has been so hard on our relationship with Christ, our personal relationship, because you're stuck at home, church looks different, you're not, like, in that community of believers pouring into you and you pouring into others, so it's so hard to, like, maintain that relationship with Christ. So I think this mission trip was, like, super important and very helpful when it came to just, like, being refilled in the Spirit by everybody around you and being in community with other believers. And, yeah, getting to know each other, and also I think it was really good because there were speakers there being able to pour into us because COVID has taken it out of a lot of us. So, but yeah, I think I just wanted to share that with you guys. Sorry, I wasn't really prepared. I didn't know what I was thinking, but
thank you.
Yeah. So this thing, we've had this banana for a little while, and it's gotten brown and mushy. I'm sure you all have experienced similar things at your house with bananas. But we're gonna use this as an illustration this morning. Okay. So normally, if this was, well, raise your hand first. Does anybody like bananas? Anybody like eating, like not this kind of banana, but you know, like a yellow good banana. I like bananas. I think they're pretty tasty, right? They are very good in smoothies, this is true. So, if this is a normal banana, we would probably, I mean, if you wanted a banana, you would eat it, right? That would be its use, to eat it, to nourish our bodies, and that. Now, let me ask you guys a question. Would you want to eat this?
No.
Why not?
Because it's mushy.
It's mushy, right? It's kind of... I mean, you could eat this and you'd probably be okay, but yeah, it's kind of mushy and kind of nasty, and so typically people don't just eat straight bananas like this. Is there anything else that it could be used for? Any other purpose that it could serve? Banana bread, okay. Banana bread is one of my all-time favorites. Anything else that you could use a banana that's rotting and decaying? Compost. And what does compost do for those of us who don't know what compost is? What does compost do? What does that mean? Turns into dirt. Kind of use it as like fertilizer, right? That's very, very good. I was hoping somebody would give that answer. So the point is that even though... come on up if you want to come up and join me. Come up and have a seat. So if we can't eat this, that's one use of this that's kind of done away with, right? But there's other ways that this can be used, correct? We can use it for compost, or we can use it for banana bread or different things. So this morning, Chad is going to be preaching a sermon on Acts 16. He's going to be talking a little bit about Paul and Silas being in prison. Now let me ask you guys, normally it's good to not be in prison, right? Normally it's good to be free, right? But if you find yourself in a bad situation, my question is, can that situation still be used for some other purpose? Yes, it can. Very good. Does anybody know just the basic idea of how God worked in the story where Paul and Silas were locked up in prison? Does anybody know how that story ends? You remember how it ends? He gets out of prison. God sends a miraculous earthquake that frees not only Paul and Silas, but it opens up all the prison doors, which is kind of scary for the jailer. Now, does anybody know what ultimately happens to the jailer in that story? Anybody know? He's pretty upset at first because he thinks, oh my goodness, I let all these prisoners get out, like I'm done for. But then what actually ends up happening is Paul and Silas, they preach the gospel to him, and he gets saved. He actually, him and his whole household, they become believers in Jesus. And so what God did is he took a really hard, bad situation, and not only did he set Paul and Silas free, but he also brought about somebody's salvation. He actually saved them and their whole household. And so, just like with our mushy banana here, that maybe one use is gone, or we eat, but there's other purposes that can come out of it. In the same way, God can take a situation like being locked up in prison, and not only can he work in the people who are locked up's lives, but he can work in other people's lives through that. So God can use any situation, and he can work it for his glory and use it for some pretty amazing things. Okay, so let me pray for you guys real quick, and then you will be dismissed. Father, I just want to pray for these kids, Lord. I'm so thankful for them, and God, I pray that for any of them who have not trusted in you, Lord, as Lord and Savior, Lord, that they would come to know that their sins, and that they need to turn from their sin and trust in you for salvation and born again, Lord. I pray that you be working in our hearts, Lord. I pray that you be working in each of their families' lives, God. And Father, just continue to help this church to really nurture and grow up these kids. They're such a wonderful blessing. I'm so thankful for each and every one of them. I pray that you be with them, keep them safe, and just keep them in you. In Jesus' name.
Thank you for preaching my sermon, Alex. We are going to be in Acts chapter 16 this morning, so you go ahead and turn there with me. Most of you know we've been going through Exodus, but taking a short break from Exodus. And starting last week, we have a four-week series that's really kind of corresponding with a journey that I'm taking through the New Testament. So for these 4 weeks starting last week, I'm reading through the New Testament personally, and just seeing week by week where I'm going to land for my sermon. So this week is Acts chapter 16. And so if you turn to Acts 16, we'll begin in verse 16. We'll read here in a moment. But first, just let me ask you something. Do you come to church on a Sunday morning, gather together for worship, stand together, sing, and maybe you just feel like you don't have a song to sing. Now, I know this morning, maybe you didn't know what a song that we sang. We sang some songs from the youth mission trip, and that's wonderful for us to do that. But just scratch that. I'm saying, like, you know the songs, but you just don't have a song to sing. I don't know if maybe you ever feel that way, especially with all the things that we're going through in the world today. It can really kind of wear on us, right? And maybe it's not too uncommon of a feeling. But I do want to encourage you this morning with the testimony of Paul and Silas. And so most of you know that my youngest child is named Silas. And I named him that in large part because I love this story that we're going to look at in Acts chapter 16. So Paul and Silas are the main characters. It begins with a really bizarre encounter with a young slave girl who has a demon. So we'll get into the details when we read through it. But there's this bizarre encounter. Ultimately, though, it's really because of Paul and Silas' gospel ministry that they are beaten. They're thrown into prison, and we find here in this passage Paul and Silas there in this dark dungeon, an inner prison at midnight, and they're singing praises to God. They're singing. Now we need to just pause right there and think about how incredible that is. You know, just that they're in such a terrible situation, and yet their instinct is to sing praises to God. And so that's incredible enough. But then we do see on top of that some miraculous intervention. And really the story is just nothing short of incredible, everything that unfolds. So I titled this sermon, Praising God in Prison. And we're going to go ahead and read the passage. This is a longer passage, so I want to encourage you to read through with me, to listen. I know sometimes whenever you go through longer passages, it's easy for your mind to start wondering. It's a little bit easier, though, when it's a story and what an incredible story this is. So I do want you to stand with me, if you would, in honor of reading God's Word. And we're going to read verses 16 through 40. As we were going to the place of prayer, we were met by a slave girl who had a spirit of divination and brought her owners much gain by fortune-telling. She followed Paul and us, crying, "These men are servants of the Most High God." Now, by the way, the us here, Luke is part of the company because Luke is the author of Acts. So that's just a little free information for you there. And so here's what the slave girl is saying. She says, "These men are servants of the Most High God who proclaim to you the way of salvation." And this she kept doing for us for many days. Paul, having become greatly annoyed, turned and said to the Spirit, "I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her." And it came out of her that very hour. But when her owners saw that their hope of gain was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace before the rulers. And when they had brought them to the magistrates, they said, "These men are Jews, and they are disturbing our city. They advocate customs that are not lawful for us as Romans to accept or practice." The crowd joined in at attacking them, and the magistrates tore the garments off of them and gave orders to beat them with rods. And when they had inflicted many blows upon them, they threw them into prison, ordering the jailer to keep them safely. Having received this order, he put them in the inner prison and fastened their feet in stocks. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. and the prisoners were listening to them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened, and everyone's bonds were unfastened. When the jailer woke and saw that the prison doors were opened, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, supposing that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul cried with a loud voice, "Do not harm yourself, for we are all here." And the jailer called for lights and rushed in, and trembling with fear, he fell down before Paul and Silas. Then he brought them out and he said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And they said, "Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, you and your household." And they spoke all the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in the house. And he took them the same hour of the night, and washed their wounds, and he was baptized at once, he and his family. Then he brought them up into his house, and he set food before them, and he rejoiced along with his entire household that he believed in God. But when it was day, the magistrates sent the police, saying, "Let these men go." And the jailer reported these words to Paul, saying, "The magistrates have sent to let you go. Therefore, come out now and go in peace." But Paul said to them, "They have beaten us publicly, uncondemned men who are Roman citizens, and they have thrown us into prison. And do they now throw us out secretly? No, let them come themselves and take us out." The police reported these words to the magistrates, and they were afraid when they heard that they were Roman citizens. And so they came and apologized to them, and they took them out and asked them to leave the city. So they went out of the prison and visited Lydia, and when they had seen the brothers, they encouraged them and departed. By the way, Lydia, we read, described before, was a convert that they had also there in Philippi. Let me go ahead and say a word of prayer. God, we thank you for this incredible story, this incredible testimony to the faith, Paul and Silas, but then also just this miraculous intervention and the way that we see you work in this situation. Salvation of the Philippian jailer, before that, Lydia. Lord, we pray that as we dig into this text this morning, that we would you grant us understanding. We would see how we can apply this to our own lives. We can pray all this in Jesus' name. All right. So we'll just jump right into it, and have a few points for the sermon this morning. And the first point is: bad things happen to believers. Bad things happen to believers. That may not be all that encouraging of a point, but it's true. And yet, we see in the story how it can indeed be encouraging that to see how God works through such situations. You know, if anyone tries to sell you that being a Christian means that all your problems go away, don't buy what they're selling. You know, it's either that such a person, maybe they just haven't read their Bible much, either that, or they don't believe it. Because we see throughout the scriptures, of course, all kinds of examples, including this one, examples of how, some big-time troubles are going to come your way if you're a believer. We see examples, and we see just explicitly stated throughout scripture. So that's important for us just to understand from the very beginning, right? Bad things happen to believers. So in verses 19 through 24, we see that Paul and Silas, because of their gospel ministry, that they were seized, they're dragged into the marketplace, they're publicly attacked and shamed, they're beaten with rods, stripped of their garments. I mean, that's not a good day, is it? Right? We see some bad things here are happening to Paul and Silas. Finally, they're thrown into this inner prison. They have, their feet are fastened with stocks. Jail back then, I think, was a lot worse than it is today. And so this things were not going to not going very well for Paul and Silas. I wonder if, as Paul and Silas were experiencing this, if maybe the words of Jesus came to their mind. Do you remember Jesus? In the Sermon on the Mount, what we call the Beatitudes, the series of sayings that Jesus gives, blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are, and he He goes on to say, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Blessed are you when you are persecuted. Right? I don't doubt for a minute that those words came to Paul and Silas' minds. And we ought to remember those words as well. Right? Maybe we're not likely, at least presently, to experience that same kind of persecution, but you know, as we move along, it seems like it's more and more likely for us to face various kinds of persecution for our faith. Be ready for it. Understand that bad things will happen to you, not only in spite of your faith, but sometimes because of it. Right? Sometimes because you're a Christian, bad things might happen to you. Again, we see that explicitly said in the scripture by Jesus himself, and then we see example after example, including this one this morning. But do not be discouraged, right? We need to heed the words of Jesus. We need to recognize that it is that we ought to consider ourselves blessed. We know that God blesses those who are persecuted for his name's sake. We heed the words of Jesus and also the example of Paul and Silas. And by the way, you know, we can see in Paul and Silas' situation, we can see it as representative of all kinds of difficulties that might come our way, right? Maybe persecution for being a believer, but really any kind of difficulty that comes our way. And we all face difficulties, don't we? We all face bad stuff, right? There's no use in trying to get around that. So Paul and Silas, they give us a good example. So what is that example? Well, we'll move on to the next point. All right, so bad things happen to believers, but then here's what we see in Paul and Silas. We see prayer and praise to God can pierce even the deepest darkness. So we see in verse 25, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. It's not any surprise to me that they were praying. I know that if I were thrown into a dark dungeon after being publicly beaten and stripped of my clothing, I would be praying to God, right? But what's, I think, really remarkable here is their singing, right? I don't know how naturally that would come to me. I think seeing this example now, maybe following Paul and Silas' example, I would sing to the Lord in prison, but I don't know how naturally that would come. You know, like I said, I mean, goodness, you know, sometimes there are things going on in our lives that are nothing compared to what Paul and Silas are going through, and we might feel like we don't have a song to sing. Now, first of all, I'll just say kind of stepping aside, there are all kinds of songs we can sing, right? Look at the Psalms, and the Psalms, there are Psalms of the sorrow, Psalms of lament. But even those Psalms, they almost always kind of evolve into praise, right? They kind of have this resolution of praise. And so it always kind of makes its way toward that. And I'll share with you here in a moment why I think they were specifically singing songs of praise here in this Philippian jail. But this singing, it really is remarkable. And passage that I think is 1 Thessalonians 5, 16-18. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Of course, Paul wrote those words to the Thessalonians. And here Paul and Silas, I mean, they're really doing this to the max, right? They're praying continually, they're being joyful, they're rejoicing. They're giving thanks, they're giving praise to God. I think that all kind of goes hand in hand here. Now let's talk a little bit more about the singing. Though, as far as the singing goes, we don't know exactly what they sang, right? It says here in my Bible, the ESV, that they were singing hymns to God. So they're singing hymns. Some translations, like the King James Version, says they were singing praises. The New American Standard Bible says they were singing hymns of praise. The Greek word here is where we get our word hymn from. It sounds kind of like hymn, hymnum, right? You get the word hymn there. But here's something that's helpful for us to understand. This is a verb, right? So we use the word hymn as a noun, right? We say we're going to sing a hymn. But this is a verb. So there's not a separate word for the word singing, right? Singing hymns is this Greek word, right? It's like the hymning, right? It's a verb. It's a verbal form. And so to sing these hymns to hymn there is an implication of praise here, right? So if you look at the different dictionaries, and of course you see it reflected in some of the English translations, you see that there is an implication of praise, right? And so I think because of the use of that word, that we see that Paul and Silas were indeed singing praises to God. And so the question is, how can they be singing praises to God in such a terrible situation? I think it's similar to how we can have joy in the midst of trials. So I've said something like this before, you know, and I'm sure you've heard a lot of people talk about this, and yourself have maybe thought about, you know, the difference between happiness and joy, right? Just these different ideas of maybe how the world thinks of being happy, but biblically speaking, there's something much deeper than that we use the word joy for. And so happiness depends on circumstances, right? Right. So it's like if something really good happens to you, then it's going to make you happy. Right. There are certain circumstances that are really essential for happiness. Happiness depends on circumstances, but joy comes despite circumstances. Right? So happiness depends on circumstances. Joy comes despite circumstances. That's why James can say, you know, count it all joy when you face trials of various kinds. Because even in the midst of difficult times, we can have joy because it's not dependent upon our circumstances. And so likewise, we ought to praise God despite our circumstances, right? We are called to praise God despite our circumstances, right? Going back to that passage in 1 Thessalonians, I think there's kind of a parallel here. Give thanks in all circumstances, right? So even if you're in a Philippian jail cell, give thanks, give praise to God, yes. Right? We can praise God, we ought to praise God, even despite our circumstances, even despite our feelings. Now again, I said, you know, you look back, you can Psalms, and you can see that there are different kinds of Psalms that are to express different emotions, but almost always does end in praise to God, even in the midst of very difficult times. And so we see that we can and should praise God despite our circumstances, despite our feelings. You know, I've come to find that sometimes singing is an overflow of what I already feel, right? So like we gather together for worship, and we're singing, and like, you know, I already feel these things, and singing is just kind of an overflow of it. But other times, singing can be something that stirs up what is maybe lying dormant inside, right? So we have these affections for God, but maybe we aren't really feeling them. They're lying dormant, but then singing stirs those up. Okay? Now, singing, of course, singing is important, but we don't have to limit this to singing. There are different ways we can praise God, right? It's really about having a certain kind of attitude and giving some kind of expression to that attitude. So singing is a great way to do that. We see that in the example of Paul and Silas. And so again, it can be an overflow, but it could be stirring something that was already dormant. And I think, especially that second example there is really what I'm trying to say here with the second point is that prayer and praise to God can pierce even the deepest darkness. So imagine you're draped in a black velvet cloth. All you can see is darkness, right? You just drape in this black belt cloth, but you get a pin, you start making these pin pricks. And so light floods in, you get these little holes, and it doesn't seem like much light, or you know, to you and I, it wouldn't seem like much light. But if you're in that darkness, and that, you know, it might seem like the most brilliant light you've ever seen. Or you know, kind of like when you look in the night sky, you see the stars scattered in the night sky. These are little glimpses of God's glory that are given to us in some of our darkest moments. So I like to think this is Paul and Silas as they're sitting in that jail cell. You know, first of all, this is a really dark time for them, you know, emotionally, spiritually, but it's also quite literally dark. You know, they're in the inner prison at midnight. Notice later we read that when the jailer realized what's going on after the earthquake, they have to bring in lights and bring in torches, presumably. Right? They didn't have lights to flick on. This is dark even in the literal sense. And so what do? They sing. They pray and sing praises to God. And again, I'm sure that in that alone, that Paul and Silas had a glimpse of God's glory. Again, just as those pinpricks in black velvet cloth or the stars in night sky, or you might say a diamond against a black backdrop. Right? Sometimes God's glory is seen in the most wonderful ways in the midst of our own darkness. But Paul and Silas gives an example, don't they? They give us an example of singing praises to God, praying to God, having a certain kind of attitude, orientation of heart. Right? And so whenever we are facing dark times, we need to remember that. Prayer and praise to God can pierce even the deepest darkness. And beyond these specific, forms of expression, especially if we talk about singing, yes, that's important, but there's an attitude, there's an orientation of the heart that we ought to have in the midst of our trials. So we could stop there and just see that, okay, this is an incredible testimony that Paul and Silas give to us. Just they're praying and they're singing there in the jail cell. But the story continues, and so we move to our third point. The third point is that God works all things for His glory and our good. It's a phrase that I use often, and I think we see it in this passage. So let's begin with the first. How does God work this crummy situation for His glory? Well, verse 25 again, that's kind of where we're centering on here. Verse 25 says, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. So right there, we see not only is Paul and Silas, you know, not only giving a testimony to us, but to these prisoners that were there with them, right? Luke here, in the book of Acts, he makes a note here that the prisoners were listening to them. Understand, Christian, that people are watching and they're listening to how you deal with adversity. When adversity comes your way, people are watching. People are listening. And so, what are they going? What are they going to see? What are they going to hear? Right? We see an incredible testimony from Paul and Silas. You know, the people think, "What in the world do these guys have to sing about?" And yet, as they listened to the words, I'm sure they figured it out. I bet they probably knew a little bit about Paul and Silas anyway. First we see that the prisoners were listening to them. We see this testimony. How else do we see God's glory revealed in this? Well, of course, beyond this, we see that God works in a miraculous way. So verse 26, suddenly there was a great earthquake. So the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were open and everyone's bonds were unfastened. That's really an awesome scene, isn't it? And of course the earthquake had something to do with the doors breaking open, but bonds, I don't know. It seemed like maybe there was something even more supernatural going on. It wasn't only the earthquake that God was using, but all of their bonds broke apart as well. And as awesome as this was, we see that this could have ended in the jailer's death, right? Could have ended in the jailer's death. So verse 27, when the jailer woke, he saw the prison doors were open And he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, supposing that the prisoners had escaped. So first of all, the jailer, he was asleep, and so he probably already had this sense of, oh man, I'm going to be in trouble, even though he couldn't help the earthquake, right? But he was asleep. And regardless of whether he could help it or not, the simple fact is that back then, a jailer was responsible for the inmates, period. And in fact, oftentimes, a jailer, if an inmate escaped, the jailer would receive whatever penalty was due for that prisoner. And so, with all of that, we don't know what all kinds of prisoners were in there, but apparently he felt like it was better for him to end his own life than to face the penalty that he was going to have for these jailers, for these prisoners getting away. And so Paul and Silas, they find themselves at a point of decision, right? The question is, okay, do I flee or do I stay? This can be like a choose your own adventure book, right? You know the choose your own adventure book, so you can get to choose. I wonder which one you would choose. Would you choose to flee or would you choose to stay? I'm really glad that Paul and Silas, they chose to stay because we see the conversion of this Philippian jailer as opposed to his tragic death. Now, I don't know, maybe the other prisoners were pretty upset with Paul and Silas because Paul jumps in, verse 28, he says, Paul cried with a loud voice, "Do not harm yourself, for we are all here." Right? So it seems as though none of the prisoners were able to escape, and Paul's speaking up in such a way and preventing the jailer from harming himself. It turned the tables, and so because of this, Paul and Silas were given this incredible opportunity to share the gospel with this jailer. So what we have here is a combination of things. And this is often how God works, right? He works, yes, in a miraculous way, but he also works in and through we have human responsibility in God's sovereignty, right? And so we have the responsibility to choose wisely, to spread the gospel. And so we see Paul and Silas' testimony, plus this miraculous intervention, plus Paul and Silas' selfless choice to remain there in prison. All of this is working together for God's glory. So we'll just kind of keep making our way through this, verses 29 through 30. The jailer called for lights, and he rushed in, and trembling with fear, he fell down before Paul and Silas. And then he brought them out, and he said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" Isn't that incredible? I mean, have you ever had somebody just come up to you and say, "What must I do to be saved?" What an incredible opportunity that is. And so, again, this all has to do with their testimony, with this miraculous intervention of God. And really, I think it even goes all the way back. I'm sure the jailer knew why Paul and Silas were there in the prison. Remember what the slave girl was saying in chapter 16, verse 17. It says, as we were going to the place of prayer, we were met by a slave girl who had a spirit of divination. And, I'm reading the wrong verse there. We'll keep going to 17. So she brought much gain to her owners before she told her. Verse 17, then she followed Paul and us, crying, "These men are servants of the Most High God who proclaim to you the way of salvation." Now that's kind of interesting, isn't it? That this demon-possessed girl is actually speaking the truth. You see it in other cases, don't we, where demons recognize who Jesus is and speak who Jesus is, and actually Jesus, in one sense, quiets them because his time had not yet come. But here we see this this slave girl who has a demon. She's proclaiming something that is very true. These men are servants of the Most High God who proclaim to you the way of salvation. And so now this Philippian jailer, he wants to know, what is this way of salvation? What must I do to be saved? So it says, "Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, you and your household." And And then in verse 32, we see that Paul goes on to speak to him the word of God. And so he says more than just that, right? He gives to them this full gospel message. And we see this conversion of the Philippian jailer. Let's read verse 34. So we see verse 31 is where Paul says, believe in the Lord Jesus, you will be saved, you and your household. Verse 32, they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in the house. And he took them the same hour of the night, and he washed their wounds. And he was baptized at once, he and his family. Then he brought them up to the house, to his house, and he set food before them, and rejoiced along with his entire household that he had believed in God. So this jailer ends up washing their wounds, taking them to his own home, feeding them. I mean, really just an incredible turn of events, right? So we see how God is glorified in this quite clearly, don't we? Right? God is glorified through the testimony of Paul and Silas. He's glorified through this miraculous intervention. He's glorified through their selfless choice to stay and to bring the gospel to this jailer. And then the jailer and all his household, his family, they believe, they're baptized. And so we see God works for his glory. But then how does God work this situation for Paul and Silas is good? So I said before, you know, I often use this phrase, how God works all things for his glory and our good. Specifically concerning how God works for our good, we see that in Romans 8:28, right? That God works all things together. All things work together for good for those who love God and are called according to his purpose. So if I'm not believers, right? Those who are in Christ, everything is working together for our good. But what does that mean? It doesn't mean that we get everything that we want. It doesn't mean that we avoid being beaten and thrown into prison, right? What it does mean is that he works everything to conform us into the image of his son. Because in that passage, and I know I've said this to you a number of times, this is something I always want to kind of drill in here. In that passage, Romans 8:28, when it says that God is working everything for our good, it also says that he's working to conform us into the image of his son. And I think that is specifically the good toward which God is working, right? He can make us like Jesus. And so certainly Paul and Silas, as they experience this situation, they are being conformed into the image of Christ. They are growing spiritually, right? From the persecution to their prayer and singing in the jail to the earthquake to their opportunity to share with the jailer, God was working in and through all of those things for their good. And then we also see in this case that they were delivered. So in verses 35 to 40, we see that the next day the magistrates, they tell the jailer to let Paul and Silas go. Perhaps it's because they thought that Paul and Silas had learned their lesson. Whatever the case, Paul goes on to reveal that they were Roman citizens. Roman citizens who had been beaten publicly and thrown into prison. Get uncondemned, and so that really strikes some fear into these magistrates. So it's a little bit humorous how we see that they actually go and apologize to Paul and Silas. But anyway, we see that not only are Paul and Silas they are growing spiritually through the situation, that this is a great faith builder for them. But we see that in this case, they are delivered from the Philippian jail, right? And it's true that God will often deliver us from our troubles. And we can pray for that, right? We can pray whenever we're going through a difficult time. Pray, God, will you deliver me from this trouble? And he just might. He might give you deliverance the very next day. This is like we see here with Paul and Silas. But, of course, that's not how it always works, even in Scripture. That's not how it always works. Paul would find himself in prison again more than once. In fact, later he writes the Philippians from his imprisonment in Rome, right? So here he is in this Philippian jail. We have this this first convert, Lydia, and then the jailer and his family. And so from there, the church in Philippi staying in the jail in Philippi, but then later, whenever Paul writes the Philippians, he's writing it from jail somewhere else. He's in Rome in prison. And later, probably in another imprisonment in Rome, Paul would be executed. Now, we don't know anything about Silas's death, except it died. Right? And we all die, don't we? Unless Jesus returns first, we're all going to die, and we're all going to face hardships. All this to say, go all the way back to the first point, bad things happen to believers. And yet, we continue to offer our prayer and our praise to God, trusting that He works all things for His glory and for our good. And I think that's what we see in this passage this morning. And so with that, let's go to the Lord. God, we thank you for this encouraging example. We have, on one hand, a dose of reality that bad things do indeed happen to us as believers. But we have the encouragement of seeing how, first of all, how we respond in prayer and praise to you. And then we see how you work all things for your glory, for your good. So we trust that. And we pray, Lord, that we'll keep these things in mind as we move along in this life, as we face many trials ahead. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, well, if you would stand, we're going to sing a song in closing. Hope through grace, comfort your hearts and establish them in every good work.